we found asbestos. That's a favorite.
Good evening, everyone. Could I have your attention? We're going to begin. I'm Chris Stover. I'm the Executive Director of the Canadian Center for Ethics and Public Affairs, which is co-founded by the Atlantic School of Theology and St. Mary's University. Thank you, all of you, for coming, and our live stream audience, to this most beautiful auditorium. Hasn't the Central Library given us something to be so proud of? I'm quite struck by the name of this auditorium, the Paula Reagan Hall. Paula Reagan was one of the founding supporters and a member of the board of directors of the Canadian Center for Ethics in Public Affairs for many years. Paul believed strongly that how we live matters. He dedicated his time, his money, and his energy to ensuring that CCEPA could accomplish its important work. So it's very meaningful to me that an organization that Paul helped build is hosting an important conversation in a hall that he also helped build. CCEPA provides an arena for critical thinking, a balance of perspectives on a broad range of issues, with a focus on the ethical dimensions of issues in our everyday lives. CCEPA is non-advocacy, and we won't take a position on an issue. You may not always like what you hear at CCEPA presentations, and you might not always agree with the speakers that we choose. But if you leave a CCEPA presentation having learned something or gained an understanding about a perspective other than your own, then CCEPA's goal will have been met. This talk came together very quickly in a very few days, and I'd like to thank our moderator and our panelists, the Halifax Central Library, for actually letting us in on such short notice, CCEPA's program coordinator, the mighty Katie Merwin, and all the other people behind the scenes who helped pull all the stops out so that we could do this. CCEPA is very grateful. I always have to say this. Please take the time to fill out an evaluation before you go, because we use the feedback. It's really important. Our moderator for tonight's panel is Dr. Sue Sherwin, a university research professor emerita in the departments of philosophy, gender, and women's studies at Dalhousie University. Her research and teaching focuses heavily on questions of ethics concerning matters of health and social justice. Sue is going to lay out the ground rules for our discussion, and there will be rules of engagement in order that this discussion always stay respectful at all times. And Sue will also formally introduce the panel. Thank you.
There it is. Thank you very much, Chris, and thanks to CCEPA for organizing this panel on such short notice, and really short notice. I would like to welcome everybody present in the room tonight and those who are in overflow space in the library, and also what I hope is many people who are engaging with us electronically from anywhere on the globe, as a matter of fact. So welcome to everyone. I will ask those in the room to turn off the ringers on your phone. I won't ask you to turn off your phone. If you want to tweet, that's fine. Just don't have it buzzing, please. And we will be hearing, I hope, from some of the people who are watching at a distance, as well as those here. So I am pleased to welcome you all here. The ground rules for tonight are rules primarily involving respectful engagement. This forum is a forum that's intended to help us think about some of the questions that we need to address to really engage with the questions that have become so prominent in this city about gendered violence on our campuses. So the focus really will be on trying to raise questions, and in order to get multiple perspectives, we're going to really be quite serious about short time limits for each speaker. And that includes our panelists, who I will now introduce, and I'm going to be just as hard on them as I am on the audience. Nobody gets more than 2 minutes at a shot to be speaking. The panelists will each get a chance to first say a couple of things in their 2 minutes, and then we will start engaging with a number of questions. Some questions will have come from panelists, but they will also be coming from you in the audience. And what I invite you to do is to come to the microphones to raise your questions. We're asking that you not take up the opportunity at the mic to actually make a speech, but really to raise questions that need to be addressed. And some of the panelists, if they have responses, will try and give some suggestions of where we might go with that question. There is also an opportunity for those who are participating electronically to submit questions to us as well, and we will try and take some of those questions as well. I will ask that we all try and be respectful in the questions that we pose and the statements we make, and in our response to what we hear from others, so that try not to have a lot of cheering or jeering, but trying to actually listen and encourage multiplicity of perspectives. I would like to now introduce the panelists, who are all faculty members at local universities, and we are aware that that offers a narrow, in some ways, perspective. We haven't got everybody who is interested in the topic on the panel, but we hope in our larger audience we do have quite a range of perspectives. So let me, and this was an initiative by faculty members who want to take responsibility to be moving things forward here. So I want to begin with Jayne Wark, who is a professor of art history at the Nova Scotia College of Art and Design. Jayne teaches and publishes feminist art and theory, and she has also served as chief negotiator for the faculty union at NASCAD, and that has helped ensure that she focuses on equity and justice issues on campus. Next is Jody Clarke, who is the academic dean at the Atlantic School of Theology and also teaches, researches, and writes on topics such as trauma, sexuality, dynamic psychotherapy, and human resilience. Françoise Baylis, excuse me, is professor and Canada Research Chair in Bioethics and Philosophy. She is also one of the authors of the Statement Against Misogyny and Gendered Violence, and she is one of the four faculty who submitted the complaint under the Dalhousie Student Code of Conduct. Next to Françoise is Rylan Higgins, who is a sociocultural anthropologist at St. Mary's University. And Rylan's research interests include gender and consumerism and gender inequality. He incorporates gender analysis and feminism into many of the courses that he teaches at St. Mary's. And last but certainly not least is Marnina Gonick, who is Canada Research Chair in Gender at Mount St. Vincent University and is a professor in the Faculty of Education and in the Department of Women's Studies. Her areas of research include youth cultures, gender and education, and sexualized violence. And I'm going to invite them each to speak for about 2 minutes to give us some idea of where their thinking is on this topic, and then we will begin with some questions. And I just also want to warn you that we have a very real time limit to this evening's discussion, because the library wants our event closed by 8:30 this evening. So I'm going to do my best to keep us on target, and if people go over target or don't follow the rules, that's the problem with the mics. We may, in fact, turn them off on any of you. I have power here, so why don't we begin in the order you're sitting with Jayne.
Okay, I'll make it really quick. I was asked to participate. This all was very sudden. And as I teach at an art school and I teach art history, I thought that the perspective that I might be able to bring to this would be some familiarity with visuality and visual images. And so that's a very tricky area, even among people that make their livelihood at that sort of thing. And so for a general person, the trickiness of imagery, it can be even more complicated. So that was my thinking, that would be a way in which I might be able to contribute tonight.
So we have 2 minutes. Excellent. Good job. Hang on. My timer on. I have 2 minutes now. I'm at a minute and 58 seconds. So I'm going to do a couple of things today. I'd like to look at a couple of issues. I might actually step into Rylan's territory in a second, because I think, first of all, the answer to the question that we're looking at tonight is yes, unequivocally. That's my position on it. So what are some of the factors that contribute to it? I think we're talking about the colonization of our sexuality by malignant profit-driven forces. So I think it's a huge issue, and it's affecting everybody in this room. It's affected all of us, whether we like it or not, and I think we have to be aware of it. It attacks us unconsciously. I come at this from a dynamic perspective psychologically, so I try to be aware or literate around the issues that affect us unconsciously, and this is a huge issue. Second force, I think, is what I'd like to call the rise of planet porn in our society. Porn is different now than it was 20 years ago, or 30 or 40 years ago when I was first introduced to it, and it has huge implications for brain physiology. So we actually have to deal with this. It is an epidemic. I think it'll come up later on, but it is a critical issue. I will say, I'll argue at some point if I have time to say that we actually should put a warning on pornography, that it's detrimental to your health. It actually is detrimental to your health. I'm not saying that from a theistic point of view or a valuistic point of view, but it actually physically affects you. So we need to be aware of that. The third thing I'm concerned about tonight is the erosion of two virtues in our society, the virtue of empathy or capacity to be empathic, and how we need to recultivate that and rekindle that in who we are as human beings, and also the erosion of character in our society. So I'm keen in hearing what you have to say about it, but I'm keen in exploring that. We live in a kind of a neoliberal society. We live in a world of rights, and I like to think of us as living in a world where we have responsibility for each other. How we get at turning it around from saying, when someone's violated, it is my business, it is our business collectively, and we need to respond to it. 2 minutes, I'm done.
Françoise.
I feel like I've had a lot of opportunity to say a lot of things, so I'll be very brief. I'd like to encourage people when they leave today, if they haven't already seen it, to pick up a copy of this statement for those who haven't seen it. It is the statement that many members of the Dalhousie community and others have chosen to sign. I invite you to do so as well. It's the statement against misogyny and gendered violence. Many of us came together. There's two points I really want to emphasize. One of the things we say there is we have to start to own the problem. We're never going to be able to address it or fix it unless we own it, and we all have to own it. And the second thing that's really important is I think we owe a lot of people an apology.
Okay, I guess I'll try 4 points, and Jody, can you time me? First is historical, right? Culture was coined in 1975. It was probably a pretty big problem even before that. And in those early discussions, sexual violence on campus was already part of the discussion. My second point is somewhat to state the obvious, that this is obviously a symptom or a problem rooted in a much larger one, which is sexism and gender inequality within our society, within Canadian society. I think it's fairly obvious, but perhaps still worth stating. Another way that I come at this problem is actually as a feminist father who has a 4.5-year-old boy who I would like to be a feminist son, and yet I'm not entirely sure how to do that as a father. I don't think my father would have identified as a feminist, and yet I am, and so I'm interested in issues around socialization in terms of sexuality for young people. And then finally, kind of in line with some of the stuff that Jody was saying, I come at this from political economy, which is to say we come at it from the perspective of figuring out how the way we organize, decisions we make about organizing our economy, how they shape us as people and as a society. And I'm certain that an economy that's myopically focused on growth, consumerism, and material gain is not good for gender equality.
Okay. I will say, start off by saying the issues that we've come here to talk about tonight are really complex, and they have complex explanations, and there's going to have to be complex solutions to them. It's not going to be a straightforward, you know, if we only did, you know, X, Y, and Z, everything will be solved. These incidents are about sexism and misogyny, but they're also about more than that. They're linked to racism, homophobia, and transphobia. And if we are, unless we're able to address the ways in which sexism intersects with these other forms of discrimination, we won't adequately be able to solve these issues on university campuses. We live in a time where, you know, we think things are getting better and better, at least that's the narrative. And specifically around gender issues, where, you know, teaching in a department of women and gender studies, I hear over and over again that we don't really need to talk about women's issues because everything's been solved. We're all equal now. And I think that obviously these incidents at Dal and St. Mary's demonstrates that that clearly is not the case. So we need more attention and resources focused on equity issues, not less. If administrations are serious about addressing these issues with long-term solutions and not just, you know, fixing the most immediate issue as it arises, they have to be willing to work with those of us, faculty and students, who have expertise through research, through activism, in dealing and thinking about issues like violence against women, rape culture, and masculinity. To date, in this, you know, these episodes that we're here to talk about, I don't see that happening. From the outset, I'll say that we need to reject any explanations for these kinds of events on cliches like boys just can't help it, or if girls didn't wear those short skirts, they wouldn't be at risk for being raped. So those are my opening thoughts on this issue.
Thank you all, and thank you for respecting the time limits and getting us off on a good foot. And thank you also for mentioning that there is a table outside the door there that has a lot of interesting information relevant to tonight's discussion. You might want to pick to explore it on your way out. One last comment before we begin the questions, and that's to say that even though we're talking generally about problems of sexualized violence, for many people, it's quite a personal issue, and it may, in fact, be quite a distressing and disturbing issue. And we're going to try and be respectful of that, but we understand that people may feel uncomfortable and should feel free to leave if they find it uncomfortable. And don't worry about causing disruption or anything else. You make yourself feel safe, and we're going to try our best to keep everybody feeling safe as well. Okay, I'm going to start with a question posed by a panelist and ask the panel to respond, and then we may start taking questions from the microphones interspersed with other panelists' questions and some that may come from further afield. So if you have some questions, please come to the mics. And if you find that somebody has already asked a question, even though you've been lined up at the mic for a while, if somebody's asked a version of your question, in the interest of time, please excuse yourself and give up your spot if necessary. Okay, perhaps we'll start with the question of how we should be conceptualizing the issue of sexualized violence on campus and whether it is clearly a question of sexism or gender inequality, perhaps amongst other things, or whether we need to parse it differently, whether that's the best way to be framing it. So would anyone like to respond to that? No. I could try another one. Okay, I will try another one. There you go. All right, how about pornography? What role does pornography play in normalizing sexual violence? and what ought we to be doing about this at this point? Preferably, as all of you are surely cognizant of the wars around censorship that raged around pornography a few decades back, where are we? What shall we do in terms of pornography and sexualized violence?
Well, I already kind of made a statement about a warning on pornography, so I'll expand a little bit on that, if that's okay. It's pretty obvious. Pornography's changed a great deal, so the debates of the 60s and 70s and 80s, I think, are radically different because of the nature of pornography today. Now, I don't want to blame all the ills in our world on pornography, but I'm going to blame a lot of them on pornography. And Rylan can actually talk about some of the financial forces that bring that into play. But today, most men, most boys today, so let's look at the symptomology of people at universities. So boys today, for the most part, and women too to some degree, but certainly boys from the ages of about 10 to 17 are the largest consuming group of pornography, right? Lots of men are still doing it, but that's your largest group. Now, that's the cohort that are actually now going to university. So they've had access to high degrees of fairly aggressive pornography for about 15 to 20 years, really since we've had high-speed internet, right? So they can now see it, and, well, I'm stating the obvious, right? So what does it do to the brain? Well, the brain naturally produces dopamine. So when you see a little bit of pornography, you see a little bit of dopamine is released in the brain. If you see a lot of pornography, a lot of dopamine is produced in the brain, and it actually changes how we think. It physically changes how we are. That then produces other chemicals in the brain that we actually start to binge on. So people can start to binge on pornography. I'm not a big fan of addiction theory, but they will binge on it. And again, that begins to change people's perspective on how they see how they see sexuality. They don't even know what normal sexuality is because of this epidemic in our culture. So I'm deeply concerned about it. So I do say, I don't want to put a, if I could stop pornography, yeah, I would stop it. But if I can't do that, so I would say we need to put a warning on it and begin to educate people about the actual effects of pornography, much like we do for smoking. Seriously, it does affect our health.
And does it, in fact, play a role in normalizing sexual violence? Is that, it may be addictive, but is it also giving us a sense that that violence is part of sexuality? Yes. Marnina.
Yeah, I would just like to add a little bit. I guess I'm a little bit more reluctant to say we have to get rid of pornography altogether, but what I would like to emphasize instead is that the problem is giving, you know, porn and internet porn the full scale allowance of where a lot of kids and a lot of young people, a lot of adults get their sex education. And I think if we had good sex education in schools where kids were having the questions that they wanted answered around sexuality, and if it was possible to talk about it in informed, and they would have a variety of perspectives on what sexuality is, and porn might be one option, but it wouldn't be the only one, and it may not be the dominant option. But we, as educators and school systems, have really closed the door on having discussions with young people about sex and sexuality.
And if I can, I think I'd like to just pull it back a little bit from pornography to say that what we need to be thinking about is not just the biology, but the environment and the culture and the climate that we've created. And I think in some cases there, one of the things that I would like to draw attention to is, I think, at least in the context of some of the things we're having to address right now at Dalhousie, we need to think about the link between sexual harassment and sexual assault and what happens in that normalization process. And so I think that you don't even have to go to some of the disturbing types of images or things like that that people might be watching on the internet. You just have to think about what gets laughed at or where there's social pressure for people to remain silent even if they do feel uncomfortable. And I think that those are much more difficult to think about. There is no warning to slap on that. It really is about creating spaces for people to be able to stand up, and then we're really talking about character and courage. And so we're really talking about how do we change a mindset such that it's not normal to stand by and be silent when things are happening that people know better.
Jayne, did you want to come?
Going to add that I don't want to see this whole discussion kind of end up revolving around pornography, but it certainly is obviously a very important issue. And I think that it's very polarizing, and people are for or against it, or they're for or against it on principle, not to say they're for pornography, but they're for the right to pornography. And so I'd like to, and I don't think this is the form in which we're going to be able to make any of those decisions, but it might be the form in which we can discuss where those kinds of conversations can take place and how the question of consent and violence and all of the kinds of ramifications from that can take place. So where is it in the home? Is it in the public school? At what level? Because these issues are so polarizing, the last thing that I want to see is a return to those wars in which pornography equaled obscenity, and we have politicians now telling us what we can and cannot do and see, and that's what it's come to before, and there's every possibility that it could come to that again. So I think it's I think what we need is nuance, and I'd like to maybe hear from some people about where they think these kinds of conversations ought to be taking place.
Yeah, so I'll just add a little bit too. So it relates to my concerns or sort of thinking about socialization in terms of sexuality. And with a four-year-old who will soon be a six or an eight-year-old, I'm seeing things with him and his friends where young kids, three or four, have this awesome sort of comfortableness with their bodies. They're inherently uninhibited. And then by the time they're six or eight, we've taught them to be very nervous and scared and inhibited about their bodies. And then by the time they're 12, they're completely engrossed in this hyper-sexualized media culture, which includes a very different pornography from 80 years ago. And you couldn't get a more sort of discongruous, odd sort of way where we bring our children into the sexual world. It's amazing that anyone has a healthy sexuality, if you ask me.
So does it even seem possible today to develop a life-enhancing and vibrant sexuality in our society? I mean, how do we manage to do that when we're surrounded by heavily colonized misogyny and pornography? How do we raise children to see sexuality as something other than what the internet is selling them?
I'll pick up on Rylan's last point. I don't know for sure what healthy sexuality is, but I'd like to have a conversation about it. And I think that the key is for us to be free enough to have a conversation. Break the traditional ways in which people communicate. Just be much more frank, much more open, much more honest about it. I didn't want to say unequivocally I'm opposed to pornography. What I said was that there should be a little proviso before that, you know, that you can actually make a choice about this. And I can knowledgeably say, I'm going to use pornography right now, and this is why I'm going to use it, and I can inform myself and others why I'm doing it, right? So that level of discourse is something we need to begin to have if we're going to have it. But I also want to say that, you know, it's like smoking. It's not necessarily healthy for us, so we need to be aware of what we're doing and why we're doing it in our society. So I'd love to have a frank conversation with people, but how often do we have that? I think that's one route forward. I like, too, the point of courage, to have a courageous conversation. For men in locker rooms to stand up and say, wait a second, I don't agree with this behavior, I don't agree with it. And to have the courage to do that. When we hear that someone's being sexually assaulted in another room, we say, wait a second, that's not okay. You know, somebody can say to us, well, no, you don't have any responsibility, that's not your right, what are you doing going in there? But we say, actually, it is my responsibility when I see someone else in pain or distress, that is my business. It changes the discourse.
And that's part of what we're here this evening to do, is to be finding, just thinking about what sorts of conversations we really do want to be having and what are the questions we need to pursue more fully. I don't mean to put you on the spot to solve these things, but to be thinking about where we go next in asking these questions. Marnina?
Yeah, I have to admit, I'm getting a little nervous when I hear the term healthy sexuality, because I think in the past it has been used in incredibly oppressive ways, and in ways that, I mean, today people who we might consider to have a healthy sexuality in previous generations, they were the ones who were being put in prison and for their expression of sexuality. So it makes me very nervous to try and have a conversation which puts limits and boundaries around what's considered a healthy, you know, a healthy sexuality. That it just makes me nervous. I think it's about a question of consent. I think that's what we need to be talking about.
Okay. I don't see speakers in our room wanting to raise questions, but we do have some from afar, so let me try one of those questions. And I don't know where this is coming, but we have, through the internet, had the question, what role do you think the technology and social media play in these issues? How much is this a modern problem within social media? Any comments?
Well, I think the obvious thing around the use of social media is it allows people to stand behind some kind of barrier or veil or think that they can be disconnected from the things that they say and or do. And then there's all kinds of questions about whether or not when you see yourself as invisible and unable to be targeted or identified, if you think you're freer to do things that you might not say and or do if they were able to, in a very direct way, attach to you. I think it's much harder to do something that is hurtful, clearly, obviously hurtful to another person when you're sitting beside them. But if you put a barrier between the two of you and you can't see each other, you can't even see the person's hurt, you might be able more easily to take pleasure in whatever poking you think you're doing. So I think that that's one of the things we need to think about. I think there's this expectation that if I am somehow anonymous, I have more license to do things.
And I would add, especially if one has allies, that it amplifies that tendency, I would conjecture.
And of course, the Dalhousie incident in the dental school is a product of social media. It is a Facebook page that has provoked the discussion, immediate discussion at Dalhousie right now. So,
well, I think one of the interesting things about it is that it has created evidence in a way that I think people didn't think the evidence would be available. And I think that that's a really important thing for us to think about, especially in the context of some of the challenges we're experiencing in terms of how we understand and use our sexual harassment policy. Because one of the problems with our sexual harassment policy at Dalhousie, which we will have to address, is it requires a complainant to come forward and to be identified. And the question we are asking is, when you have evidence, why should anybody have to attach themselves to the complaint? Anyhow, I mean, I think that that's one of the things that we really need to think about is, and I guess the other thing I want to say that's really important is that I think this really is only coming to the fore because there is that evidence. And one of the things that I worry about is what else has been going on and for how long.
Would you like to ask a question?
Yes, Pat McCray. I was an exchange student in Sweden, and just two things I'm interested in. One is, in Sweden, sex education starts in kindergarten. Is there any evidence that shows that sexual violence against women is different when they have that start? The second, in Sweden, there are sanctions against people who drive while intoxicated. You lose your car, you lose your license, you pay a fine. It's just socially not acceptable. So do we have to have more sanctions so that people won't commit these kind of behaviors? Thank you.
I think that also echoes the question around sanctions. This echoes another question that's come in from the internet, wondering whether severe punishment is the approach to take when we uncover evidence that there has been misogyny and abusive behavior. Is it appropriate to focus on punishment, or should we be working towards prevention? Not speaking of particular cases, but the general problem, are sanctions a good strategy when we do have evidence that a problem has gone on?
Well, I think that there's no reason to say it's one or the other. Obviously, both have to be happening at the same time. There has to be preventative measures as well as consequences when something is revealed. I think that, and you know, I think institutions have to be accountable and demonstrate that they're seriously working towards prevention, and that when something happens, that they are addressing it in a serious way. I think the calls for aggressive consequences are partially about a distrust that institutions are serious about dealing with these issues.
So it's an evaluation of institutions as well as individuals.
That, I think so.
That's an issue here.
I'd like to add something to that, and also what Françoise was saying about policies, and if you have evidence, why are you requiring the complainant to identify, et cetera. We have policies in our universities, at least in mine. They're called whistleblower policies, and they allow people to make complaints, usually about administrative things. They find out somebody's grafting money, or you know, that they're meant to protect the university at some kind of administrative level. And in those kinds of complaints, anonymity is ensured. So we're allowing anonymity to be ensured when it is in the interests of the institution for self-preservation reasons. And I just think that underscores the contradiction and the hypocrisy between that and then what we essentially subject our students to, and other faculty who, and any staff in the institution who might make those kinds of complaints. But we've already got it covered. We just don't have it covered there.
Gee, inconsistency in institutional policies. Who would have thought? But yes, we want the best policies in the places they need to be. Françoise.
Yeah, I think I'd like to just add a comment with respect to the issue of sanctions, retribution, education, prevention. I think, as was already said, in any individual case, you may want to have a range of things happen in response to evidence about what is at issue. I think the complication, though, that we are going to have to pay attention to is in the context specifically of professional schools. Because I think there are immediate incidents, and then there are ripple effects throughout our community. And I think the thing that I'm acutely aware of in the context of my own work in terms of training professionals is that we are giving them a license to work with patients, perhaps in private contexts. And I have to tell you that, at least in this case, I've started to do a fair bit of research in terms of what happens in the profession, and I'm quite disturbed about some of that. And so I'm worried and wondering now about what's happening in terms of the training in general. So in theory, you would want to do preventive stuff. You'd want to make sure that you're doing the right kind of education in the first place. And if you identify problems, you want to do a whole lot more education, both for the individual and then systemically for the school. But I think we need to think carefully about what we think of as retribution versus what we think of as just protecting people. And so there might be ways in which there are consequences which a person feels that they are being punished, and maybe they are, but there may be consequences that are not about them, they're about protecting other people. And I think we need to be really careful about how we think through what are appropriate consequences in different contexts.
Okay. We have some more questions from the floor. Would you like to?
Yes. I'm an instructor at the Nova Scotia Community College, and I've been aware for probably a decade of the statement that says 30 is the new 20. And I begin to see that perhaps in our society, where we're bombarded with far more access to sexual imagery and ideas than I was when I was growing up, that if the people who are now in their mid-20s are really not at the maturity level than I was at that time, does the research show that that is the case, that perhaps even people in their mid-20s lack a certain maturity, could have a little bit of naivety about the consequences of their actions, and because I really wonder where do people and when do people experiment with what you know would be considered experimentation against societal norms. When I was in my mid-teens, perhaps that happens now in the mid-20s. And does that have anything to do with post-secondary education here and our students in the mid-20s? How are they in their development and so on? And should that come into the picture at all?
Anybody want to do that? I'm not sure we have the expertise in the age of majority.
Is your question basically, are 25-year-olds a lot less mature than they used to be? Wow.
and as a consequence, perhaps we need to help them learn to be more sexually mature, even if they're dental students at Dalhousie.
I think that's an interesting question. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure I can provide an answer. I mean, I think I am comfortable with saying that the way that people are socialized around sexuality has changed, at least somewhat. Pornography, not to go back to it too much, I know, but it really has become a lot more available and mainstream. Jody was pointing out stuff that I commented on earlier today, which is that it's AT&T and GM. They're the people who make money off of pornography right now. It's become mainstream economically. The fastest growing cosmetic surgery in the United States is labiaplasty. So I think things are changing. Does it mean people are less mature? Not necessarily. But I think there is a shift in how people are being socialized around sexuality. I think that has to play a role in how people relate to each other as men and women and people of all different gender identities.
Another question? Moving around. I'm sorry. I'm supposed to change mics, but I will go here. You've been waiting longer.
Thanks. I wanted to return to a point that you brought up, Marnina, that consent is the important question discussion to happen right now. I remember when I started going to university over a decade ago now, the slogan was no means no. And it's really exciting for me to hear consent being brought up in the media, because I think that takes a very important step in the right direction. And I wonder, why is that difficult to discuss? Why are we hesitant or unable to break down what consent is?
Okay. It is a difficult question. I think it's, I think it goes back to my complex issues, complex explanations, and complex solutions. I think there's now more understanding about what consent entails and how to negotiate it, and it's something that needs to be negotiated rather than something that is obvious and expected. I think, as social beings, humans were complicated, and I think there's all kinds of narratives that we live with that complicate the issue of consent, one of them being romance, for example, that, things are supposed to just happen as they will. You're supposed to be swept off your feet if you're a woman and, let things unfold. The issue of consent kind of insists on a plan, a plan about that you are, expecting sex to happen, you're wanting sex to happen, and for young women that's a very difficult combination of things to negotiate because of the ways in which femininity is organized in our society that, even to this day, young women are not really encouraged to think of themselves as sexual beings, as somebody who can organize to have sex. So for me, as a sociologist interested in gender and interested in young people and young people's questions around sexuality and experiences of sexuality, those are some of the things that we're working, that's working against having good understandings of what consent is.
That connects to one of the questions that's come in from the internet, which is asking about how professors can broach the topic of consent with students, which I take it is a way of saying, is this something that we really ought to be teaching within our university courses to help students understand the complexities of the concept of consent, even if it doesn't relate directly to the material that is a subject matter for a particular course. And so is there a responsibility for professors, given how difficult this terrain is, to be bringing that into the classroom?
Well, I think that might work in some cases, but I can think of a lot of professors that I would not want to see advising students on consent. So I think that that's a tricky question. But something we might want to continue to talk about in our organizations.
No, and I mean, I guess I'll add that, you know, I see this with kind of any issue that we get coming our way these days, is that we've got to go to the schools, whether it's bullying or sexual violence. And why do we think that our educators are necessarily the people who, writ large, will have the solutions to these problems when they've been raised in the same society? The expectations on the schools can be there, but it shouldn't be only a very partial sort of strategy for moving forward with how we're going to deal with this. I don't think our institutions of education will solve this problem. They can play a pivotal role for sure, we need lots of other stuff in place, including, I would say, a much more robust civil society specifically aimed at dealing with these kinds of issues.
Now, would you like to?
I guess I'm wondering if anyone could speak to administration being held accountable or making a cultural shift within administration about abuser dynamics and what that means. So I'm wondering, how do you get administration to understand that a woman's lived experience and her current reality is more important than some men's potential? Or I think it's needed. But I guess I'm also thinking about the idea of restorative justice and how the people that should be in control of that process and being able to say no in that process didn't get a say. So how do we create a culture of people understanding abuser dynamics and who comes first in this process?
I think there were some statements as well as questions in there, and perhaps we can also focus particularly on how we can at least educate the administrators responsible for policies and practices and responses to problems that emerge in our universities. How do we get a mind shift at the senior administration level?
Well, I mean, it could go across all non-student people at the university. That might be a good place to start feminist education. Feminist education for our administrators, for our staff, for our faculty.
Yeah. I think another concern is that it's not enough to have a policy. You have to make sure your policy works. And that means you have to test your policy. So last year, in our last round of negotiations, we have a policy on sexual harassment, not sexual assault, but sexual harassment, like most schools do. And we said we wanted an audit of whether it was working or not. And they immediately thought we were looking for, I don't know, wage parity or something. And we were like, no, we really want to see whether or not, when was the last time we tested the policy? How do we know if it works? So if you are in an institution, and we may see the outcome of some current events resulting in policies being written up and put on websites, and then that somehow being perceived as being the end of the story and the solution has been attained. And it's an ongoing, this is ongoing. This, I mean, we're talking about misogyny. It's something we've been talking about for decades now. And so it's not going to be enough to just come up with those kinds of answers, I don't think.
I think what I'd like to add is I think I and my colleagues have said from the beginning that we think this is a very complicated situation, and it's complicated in large part because we don't have all the facts, but I predict that when we get all the facts, we will still conclude that it is a very complicated situation. I also want to say that at least from my perspective in terms of the processes that we've been involved in the last, I want to say week, but it feels like a lot longer than that, and for some of us it is a lot longer than that. Accountability is a very complex issue, and part of the reason the accountability is a very complex issue is because there are overt ways of thinking about accountability, and we are thinking about those overt ways. So, for example, in the statement that I made reference to, which we put out the same week that we learned about the situation, we asked for an independent committee of inquiry. That's a kind of obvious structural way of asking for accountability. But there are other ways of asking for accountability that are much more difficult to pursue and to exercise. And I will share with you one of the first media interviews that I did after the recorder was turned off. The reporter said to me, you know, I wonder if this story will last. And I said, it has to last, and you have to hold us accountable. It's your job to keep this story going. And that's what I believe. And I have to say that so far, I have been very impressed with the media. I think largely they are doing a good job. They are keeping on this story. And I think in part they're keeping on this story because they know Canadians care, Canadians are interested. And that means that we all have different ways of holding everybody accountable. And the main thing in terms of accountability is not to lose this moment. There is a will on the part of many. And I say that because we have received, I can't tell you how many emails, phone calls, etc., people just saying, thank you for doing this. And the thank you isn't for the awful things that have happened. The thank you is that we are seizing the moment. And so I guess what I want to say about accountability is we all have to hold ourselves accountable. And that's why my opening statement started with, we also owe a lot of people an apology because we haven't done that up until now, and we have an opportunity to do that now.
Thank you. Another question?
Yeah. I've been interested in the distance between our expectation around the recent scandals, this recent scandal, between our expectation for a civic response to this situation versus a corporate response. So we're not you don't really see in the media us turning to Mayor Savage and saying, you know, sexual violence is happening in our city, or Stephen McNeil, this happened in our province, or, you know, Stephen Harper, this is a Canadian issue. But there is a corporate response. We do expect our institutions, our universities, to respond to this. And I'm wondering, and what's been interesting is we've been talking sort of around the notion that sort of weak policies around this. We're not really sure how to, fueling the story is that the wheels kind of keep spinning, and we're waiting for a response or something to happen, and it's not happening in a way, in a speed or a fashion that we think it should happen. And I'm wondering, is the pursuit of research within our institutions a contributing factor? And when I frame that, I'm saying, like, Dalhousie has, in order for it to sustain its sort of business models, you know, it has about a 3-to-1 ratio, 3 undergraduate students for every 1 graduate student. That's a very costly model. University of Alberta, somewhere around 8 or 9 to 1. Creates a very hyper-competitive environment within the ranks to sort of, you know, if, you know, most professors are trying to move up through the ranks, get tenured positions. Has there been a move because of that research pressure on faculty to turn their attention away from the classrooms? And that in turn allows this sort of thing to happen within our classrooms.
Marnina?
First I'll just say that the distinction between corporate society and civil society, I would not put universities, or I would not want universities to be in the corporate society column. I think universities should be part of the civil society column, and that was the way they were originally intended to be. I think that they're moving more and more into the corporate column, and I think that's a huge problem. I think that we see that more and more in terms of the kinds of focus and the kind of approaches universities are taking to their own, their own agendas, such as, cutting budgets to faculties of arts and science, humanities, closing down departments of women's studies. And those kinds of moves are extremely problematic. So in this city, for example, Dale has a program of women's studies. It does not have a department. St. Mary's has a program in a department of women's studies, and Mount St. Vincent has a department extremely under-resourced, as many of the departments are, but extremely under-resourced nonetheless. And it's a fact of making government economic decisions on where they're putting their resources, and I think generally they're not going to education, and they're not going to turning universities into models of education that are only about providing students with skills for the market, and not about providing students with skills that they get in humanities and social sciences programs, like critical thinking, like citizenship education, and the whole notion of what civil society is comes from those disciplines that are at risk for disappearing altogether.
And perhaps we're seeing some evidence of the dangers of separating out professional job-oriented programs from the core of university and arts and sciences, and the dangers of thinking that you can educate people to a job without giving them a fuller education at this point. But I'm only supposed to be moderator, so I'll be quiet. Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, and so again, if we have that civil society, for there are increasing number of institutions that we can imagine, only imagine at this point, then there will be a need for people who have a strong liberal arts education to staff them. We don't need a new app, all right? These kind of problems won't be solved by another new app, all right? We need people who are educated in a system geared towards producing the next generation of thinkers that would then staff those institutions that can start addressing these issues.
Perhaps this is the time to raise the question of what are the limits and possibilities of education and education institutions for shaping cultural and social expectations about these matters, and specifically sexual expression, sexual violence, and sexual behavior. We've heard sort of both themes coming from the panel, that it can't just be the universities, but is there a responsibility for universities, and what do they need to deliver on that if it is their responsibility?
Well, I'll respond in part. Pam Brown's here. Hi, Pam. So about 20 years ago, Pam's a physician, and Pam and I were aware of what we would describe, and it's our description, of illiteracy among our professions. I'm an Anglican priest, and I was noticing clergy, by and large, were illiterate when it came to areas of sexuality. Now, when I'm talking about sexuality, I'm not simply talking about how biologically we function, but also our critical capacity to say this is a misogynistic function, or this is a sexist function inside our society, or the structures we have. So, and Pam, as a physician, she's certainly free to argue that, or make this point too, but was noticing it within her profession too. So people were coming to us or to my profession, and we couldn't respond adequately. We didn't know how to respond. In many ways, we were giving actually really bad counsel because we were illiterate. Pam would argue the same thing. So we actually designed a course about 20 years ago, and Friday afternoon people would have sex with Pam and Jody. And it's true, right, Pam? Yeah, exactly. So, but they would happen, and it became both playful and adventurous. And we try to, and we continue to try to increase the literacy. 20 years ago, it was an LGBT positive course, just to sensitize people to these issues, so that how people are oppressed by the activity that many people. See, the thing about illiteracy is we don't know we're doing it when we're doing it. And when I talked earlier about the colonization of our imagination by a corporate structure, it actually does do that to us. We don't know we're complicit in activities that actually demean the human fabric. We need to be much more literate about that. It's our responsibility as universities, it's our responsibility as educators, it's our responsibility as administrators. I like the idea of doing much more education about it. I'm intrigued by Dalhousie right now. I want to study it and understand it and see what positive outcomes we can have from this. It's a new target for us. So let's learn as much, I hate to say it, let's learn as much as we can from this horrific kind of expression. In some ways, it's a perfect storm right now. And I'm glad, as you pointed out, that the media is taking advantage of it. We have Jean Gomesh, we have Bill Cosby, we have hockey players and football players. We have a lot of people who are finally crystallizing the issue and bring it to a surface in a way that we are actually able to sink our teeth into and examine. So let's examine and become a much more literate society.
If I can, I would just like to add one comment that is Dalhousie specific, which is to say that all institutions have a culture and they have a climate and we contribute to it in either positive or negative ways. One of the things that I think we need to ask ourselves questions about is what was the climate in that faculty, but at our university, that made it safe for these young men to think that what they were engaging in was appropriate. And I would say that up until this point, I think it's interesting how disproportionate the attention has been on the students as compared with the faculty. And I think that one of the things that people will know is that there was an offensive video shown to the students, and all I can think is, what else was being done, creating a particular kind of climate, a particular kind of culture, which again normalizes other kinds of behaviors. And so I think one of the things we cannot lose sight of is that this is not one aberrant event happening. What it is it's just an obvious expression that we were able to grab some facts about, and that we're then with that pulling on a thread, trying to unravel whatever else was going on. So I think it is really important to understand that everything is happening within a particular cultural climate and a cultural context, and we need to look at all that's contributing to that.
Okay.
Just a bit of a counterpoint is that it's happening so many places, though. So I don't know how we can ascertain whether there is something specific about Dalhousie Dental that created this.
I don't think it's specific
right
there. I am trying to say that one of the things I hope will happen as we continue to understand what was going on there is the many people that were contributing in different ways. Because I think I don't certainly know how to do it. I think it's very difficult to understand what it is that contributes to a particular kind of culture or climate. But I'm just saying there had to be something in place that people felt comfortable doing what they were doing and not either understanding or appreciating how inappropriate, how hurtful, how offensive. I mean, I'm not even sure what words.
Sure.
I mean,
but I guess I would say that.
I'm going to move along. We have a number of questioners there, and I've got a whole lot of internet ones coming in. So please, I think you're next. Go ahead.
All right. As a female engineering student, I've obviously been asked several times now with this going on, is if I've ever heard comments similar to this, and the sad reality is my answer is, of course, obviously, and quite arguably much worse. So my question to you would be, are you, as perhaps a third party on a campus, do you ever observe behavior, males or females, that perhaps, and this may go into your comment of illiteracy going into our ignorance because of the time and the society that we grew up in, behavior that we're doing that you see as obvious as something that we should be stopping to prevent this?
Yes.
And could you please elaborate?
One of the primary places that I see it
is in a sea of people like this. I have 220 students in an introductory course, and I spend the last 2 weeks of that course focusing specifically on feminism and feminism anthropology, or feminist anthropology. And so in the questions, it's a sea of sort of, it's my intro class is interesting in that the 220 students provide for themselves anonymity. Nobody knows who anybody is most of the time, and I don't know who they are. And so they speak fairly frankly. And so when we talk about difficult issues, challenging issues about sexuality, about pornography, about the sexualized world that young people enter very early these days, there's lots of comments and snickering and the kind of things. And then when I poll everybody, there's four or five feminists in the group. And we spend the semester explaining that feminism isn't a four-letter word and that it just means you don't like sexism. Still, at the end of that discussion, two-week discussion, there might be three or more, four more people who identify out of 220 as feminists. And so I see a lot of problems emanating from that, and I'm quite frankly worried about it.
Can I ask, though, the person who asked the question? Oh, there you are. When you said we, maybe I wasn't quite sure I understood your question. Did you say like what is there something? Is there something we could be doing to?
Students, like I'm in my early 20s.
So. Sorry, we need a microphone, and so for the larger audience, I will just repeat. You're saying we as students. You're speaking of your group is who you have in mind. Here you come. Okay.
Sorry, I was saying we, particularly students, I'm in my early 20s and I already have an undergraduate degree of applied science from Acadia University. So I've always been in a male-dominated field. And like I say, a lot of these jokes come out and we all laugh, we all make jokes. And I would dare argue that females make these jokes back sometimes worse than the guys do. And we do this as a group and it's just, it's something that has definitely come to light and something that I know myself personally, I catch now, because of all this coming to light, it's like, wow, you know, we really shouldn't be saying something like this. Like, someone on Facebook said to someone else, I hope you have a rapey holiday. And I was like, whoa, no, that's not okay. And it's just, I'm wondering if there's other things that we're doing, and it's just because of the era that we're growing up in that we perceive it as okay, that perhaps yourself being much more educated on the topic and we're just ignorant to our behavior, is there something that we're doing that you would see as something that we should automatically stop? So I guess just as a bit more of an example, sorry to keep going.
Yeah, I'm gonna cut you off shortly, so sum up.
Okay, I was just gonna say, a lot of girls will go downtown looking to hook up and they'll get extremely intoxicated and they'll be extremely offended if someone doesn't approach them trying to take them home. And that's just somewhat a mindset that some people are already in. So I'm wondering if there's other things that you're observing that we as students, as my generation, that we're doing that we should stop, that perhaps we're not acknowledging, but you guys are.
Well, that was a lot. Can I just...
you can talk quickly. No, there were other...
The reason I asked is when you were saying we, did you mean we, the female students? I gather there's a sense that you need to collaborate with this offensive behavior in order to kind of be accepted within the group and not be seen as, you know, F-word feminists if you challenge that kind of behavior. And I think maybe this goes to one thing I'd be really careful of is getting into a blaming the victim mentality that, but on the other hand, accountability. So it's, I think, a tension between the kind of accountability issues that Françoise is talking about, and then on the other hand, not blaming yourselves, holding accountable both yourselves and your peers, but it's not your job. It's not your job to take that on yourselves to fix the problem. Yes, you have to address it, but don't like heap more burden on yourselves. I think we have to go at it from different angles than just that.
Maybe I can put into this some of the questions coming from the internet as well, because I think they are connected, and they have to do with why are so many people afraid to speak out? Why are there so few moderate voices? And also, building on Francois' initial suggestion, how do we create space to build the kind of courage and character that she initially suggested we need to do to stand up against harassment and violence and not just be complicit in it? So we can't just beat ourselves up. I think that's useful advice. But what can we do to help make sure somebody says that's not okay? Yes, sir. Any suggestions?
Well, I would just like to respond and say that something tells me that this isn't happening everywhere in all youth groups and all. And because I know a lot of young people who are not doing this. So the question I have, and I don't know if this is legitimate, but is there something about something, you know, one of the places that we need to look closer at are these professional schools that were traditionally male-dominated places as producing this kind of worrisome activities and behaviors and patterns of thinking. Engineering certainly would have been one of, you know, would have been one of those, you know, traditionally male places. Is there something going on around, you know, women's success in education and gaining entry into these places that were formerly male-dominated, and the kind of cost of gaining access is to produce yourself as hypersexual and hypersexualized in order to be seen as okay and not a threat in these male-dominated places? There actually is quite a lot of research that suggests that that is what's going on.
Yes.
I can't wrap my head around rapey holiday. That's distracting me. But restorative justice, I know, has worked incredibly well in certain situations where the perpetrators have expressed remorse or want to take accountability. And from what I understand, these men have only expressed remorse at being caught. And only two women have opted to take this restorative justice process. So why, in your opinion, do you think this process was chosen? And what, if any, good can come out of this faulty approach?
I
think perhaps the question carries its own answer to some extent, and we are trying to talk generically about the problems and of gendered violence and not so much about what exactly Dal is doing in this particular case. So,
if I would like to at least take the opportunity for those who are not aware of it to encourage you to go and look at the letter that was published by, from my perspective, four very courageous women who came forward to explain why they particularly were not interested in that option. And I think you can find that on a couple of different web pages that was posted a couple of days ago. And the only reason I mentioned it is because I really am in awe of those women who came forward to do that, because I think it's quite clear from their letter that they felt they were at risk even doing that.
Yes.
Hi. My question is related to, so there was an earlier question from the audience around whether or not young people were less mature now. And I think if you said that about any other group, that, you know, people of a certain generation or a certain ethnicity or a certain gender are less mature than other people without any evidence for it, we would be up in arms. But nobody said anything, right? And I think what that kind of hits at for me, or the question that poses for me, is if young people are dealing with these challenges, are they really going to listen to people from another generation that maybe don't have, that don't come from that background that they do, that maybe don't have the respect of the fact that they're coming from a different place and would say things? I'm not suggesting that any of you said that, and I'm not intending to push back hard on that individual, but I would ask you, if you're looking at a professor's perspective, are professors really the ones at a broad level that are going to deliver the kind of change that we're looking at? Is it about older people talking to young people? Or what are the strategies to encourage and support young people to talk to each other and create the culture that they have together and have a cultural change?
Marnina?
Yeah, my memory is that I didn't actually talk about that question, and I'm glad you brought it up again, because I actually did want to say something about it last time, which is that as somebody who does a lot of media analysis and pop culture analysis, one of the things that I've been noticing, and it's not just me, a lot of people have, is that we're in an era where the representations of young men in pop culture is incredibly juvenile and kind of, dumb. And there aren't very many representations of young men who are smart and savvy and interesting and not losers, and I think it's interesting that in the early days of the feminism in the 60s and 70s, one of the complaints was that women were represented as enduringly childlike and never grown up, never a full adult. And I think in interesting ways that we've kind of done a complete reversal, and now it's young men who are represented, and grown-up men, as represented as never fully reaching maturity or never reaching the stage where responsibility and is expected. And I think, to answer get back to your question, I think that, just like there has to be pushback on that this is unfair and not an accurate representation of young people, young men, and men altogether.
I'd like to add, too, that I really like the question, because I think about this quite a bit, having just recently read Vital Signs, the report out on young people in Canada, or in our province in particular. And I think about that, and I think about who is accountable for that. And it's everybody in the room over 40, and everybody in the province over 40. We've created a very stressful, economically unstable, and quite frankly troubling world for young people. And I think we can definitely link these things to various problems in our world, in our province, or in our country, including sexism and gender inequality and misogyny.
Perhaps while we're talking about young men in popular culture, we can come back to one of the panelists' questions, which asks what we want to say to Margaret Wente in response to her claim that, quote, the main campus safety risk at the moment is to the mental health of the male students who are caught up in the nightmare. Does anybody want to speak to that concern?
Well, as the person who put forward that question, I had a lot of things I want to say to Mark Wente. But if I can, I guess there's a couple of things that I think are really important. I mean, that was the quote from her statement, and I thought to myself when I read that, well, gee, what would it take for her to actually just be aware that there's a nightmare for the women involved? I mean, really? Like, that's what you can see, that the mental health of these young men is at risk, and that what a nightmare. But it isn't just that. I think for people who may not have read the commentary, it really ends up being a version of boys will be boys. And I just think, how can that be, that you would actually offer up a version of that to account for this? Why? Because we all know what boys will be boys means, right? It's code for men will be stupid and sexist. And honestly, that is such a disservice to so many men that I know who are kind and caring and compassionate. And that's the part that I think is really problematic. I think it even goes back to the earlier person's question. I mean, boys will be boys? That's not what was going on here, and that's not the way in which we should frame it. And we should be standing up
for all the men who well understand, and there are many who well understand that what's happening is unacceptable. And that's why I think for me the issue is, how do we empower people of all generations to stand up and be counted and to say loudly and consistently, this is unacceptable and it will not be tolerated. And please understand that's difficult to do for all kinds of reasons in terms of how we've been socialized, and that's when we get back to the intersectionality. It's difficult to do in the context of racism, for example. It's difficult to do in the context of homophobia. And that's what we're really talking about. We're talking about the ways in which all of these behaviors are not being addressed, and part of it is about consent in terms of certain kinds of behaviors, but I guess for me it goes back to the basics in terms of character and courage, and so I want people to tell Margaret Wente where she can take it.
We have very little time left, so...
I know. Yeah. This is going to be very brief. I know you're declining. You don't want to get into the discussion of restorative justice, but recently I've been reading a book called A Compulsory Compassion by a University of Alberta law professor, which some people might want to read. Her name is Annalise Acorn, A-C-O-R-N, and it's called Compulsory Compassion, and it's an analysis of restorative justice that would suit what we're dealing with now.
Thank you.
Can I?
Okay.
Well, you mentioned a lot about courage, and I'm terrified to say what I'm about to say. And part of my terror comes in answering the question, why is it that people do not speak? Why do we not speak about justice, restorative justice, and social justice? I have been through restorative justice. It was not misogyny, but it was murder. And it was painful, traumatic, and deeply healing. And I think that what is required is a conversation around what does justice mean and how does it mean? And that is what I am asking, because many people who support, this is part of my research, it's also my research because it's my life. I had to meet the man who murdered my father. I chose to do that. Part of what my question is how do we not do us versus them, and how do we use this as an opportunity to actually negotiate and dialogue around the fact that we are in community, with community? Is this not an opportunity to speak about that? So I am in awe when people can speak their voice. As I said, I am terrified because I know lots of people in this province and in this country do not support that. You would think that I would not, and I'm a tough customer, and technically I shouldn't. But I know that respect, responsibility, and relationship do not come unless we speak, and we have many, many, many different voices, and restorative justice invites that conversation. So why is it that we should say that no? Why can we not say, what the hell does it mean anyway? That chick met the guy who murdered her dad. That's a man. It's not misogyny, but it's goddamn murder. Are we not speaking about community, relationship, compassion, empathy? That is my question.
Thank you very much. It's very helpful. We do want diverse perspectives, and I do think that we all, many of us, need more education about restorative justice. So, thank you.
I would like to offer a few comments. I wholly endorse what's been said in terms of empowering people to speak in their own voice and to speak with respect and to speak with responsibility. I think that's absolutely key and important, and I completely agree with that. I also think you made another comment that's extremely important that I also completely agree with, that people who wish to pursue restorative justice should have that opportunity. And the point that you made is that you chose to do this, and I think that that's important that that choice be there. I do want to say, as one of the people who brought forward the complaint was not to shut down the opportunity for restorative justice for those who wanted to pursue it. It is just that we were aware that for some people, that was not the choice they wanted to make. And all we wanted to do, and what we still want to do, is to open the door for people who want other ways of engaging with the situation. So I think the important point here is choice, And I think that's very important. I think the ability to speak in your own voice in a way that's respectful and that you can look for healing is also extremely important, and I would speak in support of that. I think the part that's been very complicated around this is twofold. I don't know very much about restorative justice. I don't pretend to have authority there. I've done a little bit of research, and a couple of things that I have learned are that there's actually a moratorium in Nova Scotia on the use of restorative justice in the context of domestic violence. Now, the situation at Dalhousie, as far as we know at this point, does not involve assault, and so it's not the case that these are analogous, but it is within the same realm that I would at least want to know a whole lot more in terms of being cautious as to whether this is the right mechanism for this situation. And maybe it is, but I don't know. And I think the other thing that I would like to say about this is I don't understand how one can have healing if one does not consent to the process going into it. Because I think what you're saying is you have to have the right mindset. You have to want to meet that person, understand why they thought or why they did or why. And I think a lot more needs to happen around that. And I think the difficult thing in the situation right now at Dalhousie, from my perspective, and now I'm only speaking on my own behalf, is the very critical point that you made about living in community. And I think the interesting thing here is how do we understand community? What is, was, will be the community? And unfortunately, for whatever reason, this came to light at a very particular moment where for several of the students, it's 13 to 15 weeks before they leave, hopefully with their degree, out into the world. And I'm not sure how many people felt they were part of any kind of community at that point. We know these posts or this Facebook group is going on since 2011. As I said at the beginning, we don't have enough facts to know everything, but I think that's why it was so complicated. So if I can, just want to say, I think for those for whom it has worked, that's fantastic. It is an opportunity for other situations. It's just complicated and contested in this one.
Okay. And I think it is a complicated case in this particular case, and we do still want to be thinking broadly and that there are appropriate uses. And I think many of us need to know a lot more about the process. And it's easy to make quick judgments without knowing deeply. So thank you for bringing that to our attention. Thank you for explaining how it connects with the Dell situation. Thanks to all of you for participating. But I'm sorry for the people still waiting with questions, but my time is up, and I am now going to pass the mic to Dr. Pat Bradshaw. There are further conversations happening about this, and some of the information is out on the table. Dalhousie has a forum coming January 15th. I know St. Mary's does, but Dr. Pat Bradshaw, who is chair of CCEPA, who is hosting us tonight, would like the final word.
And the final word is a few words, actually. One is a very, very sincere thank you to our moderator, Sue. Thank you for making this. Thank you very much for making this a space that is truly a CCEPA space of safety, respect, and inclusion, where multiple perspectives can be brought to bear. Secondly, a huge thank you to the panelists. You brought your own views with clarity, with integrity, with insight, and enlightened from many perspectives the issues that are so complex. And the thoughtful pauses, I thought, were as poignant as some of the comments. So please join me in thanking the panelists. I also want to thank CCEPA staff, Chris and Katie. They've pulled this together with the help of the library, who have graciously opened their beautiful space to us. I think this is a conversation that clearly needs to continue. I've been in this province for 2.5 years, and I have to say I'm absolutely proud to be in a province that says this conversation has to happen, these dynamics have to be explored. Bullying, sexualized violence, rape culture, etc., are not tolerated. And I don't want these conversations to end, so we hope to be facilitating many more conversations where we can continue this. So thank you to everyone, and we invite you to please fill out the evaluation forms. And CCEPA's next event is February 3rd, Everyday Ethics Presentation with the Canadian playwright Hannah Mosevich, and we invite you to join us there. Thank you. Good night.
Before everyone leaves, I have an announcement to make, and thanks for this. And this is in the spirit of follow-up activities and events that many of you might be interested in. It was referred to, Sue mentioned this just a moment ago. I'm Margaret DeKnight, the coordinator of the Gender and Women's Studies program at Dalhousie University, and we have been developing an initiative that is very much like this one. It's intended to be a public conversation and a sequel to this event. It will be held on January 15th from 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock, 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock at the McInnes Room in the Student Union Building at Dal. And it will involve many people who are in this room, including, and we have a panel of students, members from the sexual assault services in our community, faculty, those who have been involved in the complaint processes. Jennifer Llewellyn will be speaking on restorative justice. It will be very similar to this. And I think is inspiring this particular moment too, as is the case here. I have been teaching gender and women's studies for some 20 years, and I have never seen so many people care so much about sexual violence, sexual harassment, racism, and we'd like to pick up that conversation. The Dalhousie Student Union is also sponsoring this, and everybody is welcome. And thank you for this.